Hello, my name is Dr. Ed Norton Thoreau, or Dr. ENT. I'm an otolaryngology head and neck surgeon. I will be reviewing three severe nosebleed scenes from three different popular TV shows, Grey's Anatomy, Private Practice, as well as one from the BBC called Cardiac Arrest. The first nosebleed scene I will review is the one from Private Practice.
Tuck, are you the therapist who told that husband to leave me?
Not a bad representation of how an individual with a bad nosebleed often walks into a clinic or ER. I'm a little surprised by how nonchalant the patient is with her nosebleed, however, which suggests she's had them before. She was doing a great job firmly pinching the nose, which is the right first step to take.
Karen,
The bleeding got a lot worse. I checked her CBC. Her hematocrit's less than 30.
Less than 30? Are you sure?
You mean there's something really wrong with her?
Yes, there's something wrong with me. You picked a great time to walk out, Doug. Just great.
Her nosebleed is considered severe given her blood count has dropped significantly. If a blood transfusion is considered, she would need at least 2 units of blood to get her blood counts back to normal. At this point, simply pinching the nose, as demonstrated in this as well as the prior scene, is simply not working. The next best step would be to either try to cauterize her nose or perform nasal packing. The patient is amazingly composed when clearly having an unusually bad nosebleed.
You have no idea who I am. You only have Doug's side of the story. I'm the bitch, and he's...
I am not on anybody's
Just
side.
Just stay away from...
It is unclear what exactly was done to stop the nosebleed in the clinic, but presumably nasal cauterization is performed as I see no obvious nasal packing and her voice sounds normal. But unfortunately, her nose starts to bleed again. Coughing out blood is common, especially when it runs down the throat. But with an active bad nosebleed, is having someone else's blood splatter against your face realistic? Yes. Yes, it is. Tipping the head forward helps to minimize coughing out blood during an active nosebleed.
You've got something called Wegener's disease. It's a disease of the blood vessels that affects the ears, nose, throat, and kidneys.
Does she?
Nosebleed as the very first symptom of Wegener's is quite unusual. Usually there will be other symptoms present and one normally would not run tests for Wegener's when working up a bad nosebleed. That said, nosebleeds can occur with Wegener's due to an abnormal hypervascular and inflamed lesions of the nasal and sinus mucosa. In this next scene from Grey's Anatomy, a patient presents to the ER in a similar fashion, but with a dramatically different outcome.
Nosebleed, huh? Let's see to stop it.
That sounds like a rough night. Been there. Trust me. Have a seat. Okay. You want to apply pressure and keep your head forward. I'll come back to pack it.
A fairly realistic example of how a patient with a bad nosebleed presents to the ER. Appropriate first step of applying pressure and keeping head tilted forward is demonstrated.
Dude, I think it's been long enough.
I don't know. I can still taste blood.
Oh, it's nothing. All right, let's see here. Oh, looks good, buddy.
PGAT or neuro.
I need Foley, packing, suction.
I need the attending.
Initially, the patient appears to have resolved his nosebleed, but note how he has kept the head tilted backwards, which is why he states he feels the blood running down the back of his throat. He probably also is constantly swallowing blood, giving the false appearance of a resolved nosebleed. The true nature of the nosebleed soon becomes apparent when blood starts to pour out of the nose and mouth, which suggests an arterial source of bleeding. At this point, there are 2 main arterial sources that can cause a severe nosebleed. The dreaded sphenopalatine artery located in the very back of the nose and the anterior ethmoid artery located near the nasal corner of the eye. I should mention that the severe nosebleed is quite realistically portrayed in this scene.
All right, call a code. What the hell's going on?
Uncontrolled posterior bleed.
Yeah, I got that. Why the hell isn't Stay already in an OR?
Ask him.
All right, back off. Back. Let's go. We need to get him intubated, open a central line kit, get some O-neg here right away. You, what's his bleeding time, clotting factor?
I don't remember. I'm juggling my
fine. Did you go to med school? What are his labs? Did you even do a physical exam?
No labs were ever ordered.
How long has this patient been here, bleeding, in the ER?
It's not my fault. He was fine.
How long?
5 hours.
Yeah, I can't visualize. I can't visualize anything. Get me a Cryte kit. You, go put the IR suite on standby. You, now, go, go!
The ER attending immediately recommends intubation, which is not incorrect, but I personally would not pursue this right away. Rather, I would immediately pack the nose and see if that's all it takes to resolve this nosebleed emergency. And rather than a central line, which would take too long, I would have two large bore IV placed instead. Keep in mind that the patient has been sitting in the ER for 5 hours. That's a long time to be actively bleeding, and the patient is at risk for severe hypovolemic shock. Once it is apparent that the patient rapidly decompensated, intubation is absolutely the right thing to do. Not sure why he is not able to intubate, as only blood would be present, which should be able to be easily suctioned away. But if he can't see the airway for whatever reason, an emergency cricothyroidotomy is perfectly appropriate in a decompensating patient. One can argue that bag mask ventilation should be performed, but given severe active bleeding, one risks forcing blood into the lungs, worsening pulmonary function.
Time for another round of epi.
No pulse with CPR.
I can't get a readout on oximetry. What happened?
Getting here, I could use some help from a grown-up. We need to embolize the sphenopalatine artery.
Now tell me what you need.
Trying to access the femoral artery. I got the right side, you take the left.
Got it. What the hell happened?
Torrential posterior nosebleed. I tried to stabilize him in the ER. Packing Foley didn't work. I got an IO line in, but the blood is barely transfusing. Damn it, I can't get in.
Me neither. Vessels collapsed. I'm gonna try to cut down.
Stop compressions. Without central access, he's done. Hold off, hold off. Stop compressions. Call it.
It was just a nosebleed.
A nosebleed that brings a person to the ER is never just a nosebleed.
In this final scene, the patient has suffered cardiac arrest from hypovolemic shock, from significant blood loss, and ultimately passed away. This particular scene shows CPR being performed, quite timidly, I should add. In order for chest compressions to be effective, one needs to really push down on the chest hard. The ER attending stated he tried to pack the nose and even use the Foley without success. Currently, he is now trying to embolize the sphenopalatine artery by threading a catheter from the femoral artery in the leg and advancing it up to the nose, which is an appropriate next step. Alternatively, a possibly better option would be to endoscopically try to control the nosebleed. Essentially, one would run a tiny rigid camera into the nose to localize the source of bleeding more precisely and perform more targeted nosebleed control measures. Compared to embolization, endoscopic nosebleed control can be performed more quickly and can act as a temporizing measure if unsuccessful for embolization to be tried later. Why? Embolization takes a long time to perform, time this particular patient does not have. Also, it is nearly impossible to insert a catheter into a collapsed blood vessel from hypovolemia when chest compressions are being performed. Imagine trying to thread a needle if someone is constantly punching you in the arm. Ideally, chest compression should be stopped briefly to allow time to quickly gain vascular access.
Please? I'm really sorry to keep you waiting. It's like a madhouse in here tonight. I'm Dr. Maitland. Let me take a wild guess. Nosebleed?
Mummy, is Daddy ever going to stop bleeding?
Yes, your Daddy's going to stop bleeding very soon indeed.
I'm a haemophiliac.
Right, well then let's get you into the resus room just in case. Julie, can you get onto the blood bank for some factor VIII, please?
Your husband's haemophiliac?
Yeah.
Okay, well, we're going to try and get hold of some factor VIII, the blood clotting factor that he lacks to help stop the bleeding.
I'm sorry to bother you. It must be rushed up your feet.
Not at all. Blood bank, factor VIII, Mr. Cullen, resus.
In this particular episode from the BBC TV show Cardiac Arrest, one sees the now familiar presentation of a patient with a bad nosebleed. The catch is that this particular patient is a hemophiliac, which means he does not have the ability to clot. The implications of a hemophiliac history is immediately recognized by the doctor who orders a factor VIII transfusion which supplies the missing clotting factors required by the patient.
I'll GNS him, just in case there's nothing to worry about.
Never packed a nose in my life. Is the ENT registrar still not on the circle?
Switchboard says that the general say he left half an hour ago.
I think it's getting worse.
Let me have a look. Oh, dear.
I'm sorry.
What bank have just called? No stocks of factor VIII. They're having to send out for some.
The doctor realizes that patient needs to be packed, but has never been trained to do so. Compounding this dangerous situation is the fact that the hospital apparently did not have factor VIII available, which means the patient will continue to bleed. The way the severe nosebleed is portrayed is quite realistic.
Mr. Cullen,
try and get the small balloon into your nose. I need to stop hemorrhage. Or you hold him still. I can't see to get this in. We need some suction going, please, now. And the fluid. And Kyle also has her own leg as soon as possible. Trisha, please. It's coming. It's on. It's on. It's on.
The actors quite accurately portray the panic of trying to save this patient's life without the necessary tools and expertise. The doctor tries the only thing she knows to do by inserting a Foley catheter into the left nose and inflating the balloon to apply pressure. This maneuver is not incorrect and can indeed work when nothing else is available. Problem is, based on what I see in this scene, I'm not sure which side the bleeding is coming from. It could be just as easily be coming from the right side. If I were in her shoes, I would place a Foley catheter in both sides.
Okay, we're in. He's losing consciousness. Let's intubate him. Oh, I can't see this. Can you try and move his neck a bit further? Yeah.
Unfortunately, placing a Foley nasal packing in the left nose does not appear to be working as he is still rapidly losing blood. Based on the canister, he's lost about 700 milliliters of blood in under 1 minute. The doctor appropriately pursues intubation to control the airway given the active bleeding, which is clearly compromising the patient's breathing. Basically, he is drowning in his own blood.
He's losing output. You do chest compressions, I'll sort the airway. What the hell's that own leg?
The patient has gone into hypovolemic cardiac arrest and CPR is now being performed. The nosebleed appears to have stopped, but it is probably because the heart is no longer pumping blood effectively.
Let's get him monitored up now, please. Quick as you can. Adrenaline 1 milligram, atropine 3 milligrams, please. Quick as you can, please. Still asystole.
ACLS protocol is now being pursued to revive the patient's cardiac rhythm. The patient ultimately passed away. I hate to say this, but the way this disaster unfolded is quite realistically portrayed from the patient presentation to how the severe nosebleed was portrayed and managed. The doctor truly did what she was able to do with the tools she had on hand, and I'm not sure if any non-ENT could have done it any better. The only thing I can see that the doctor could have done additionally that I already mentioned earlier was to pack both sides of the nose given it was unclear which side the bleeding was truly coming from. Even if an ENT was present, stopping such a severe nosebleed in a hemophiliac patient would have been challenging. In summary, these TV shows overall did a great job in realistically portraying severe nosebleeds. Different treatment strategies may have been pursued in real life, but I cannot state what was shown was incorrect either. Thankfully, death from severe nosebleeds is exceedingly rare. Also, I want to stress how frequently and commonly nasal packing is performed to control severe nosebleeds, which is not readily apparent in these scenes. Check out this video on how nasal packing is formally placed in a patient.